My charge was to make the talk not boring to people outside high energy physics, but also non-boring for high energy physicists. So I've tried to put in some introductory material to motivate some of the things we show, at the same time to include some of our more recent results. So I have a few words on why new physics, etc. It's, I suppose, obligatory. Then we look at some non-SUSY solutions to the H problem. You can define either as a Higgs problem or the hierarchy problem in terms of new interactions, bringing down gravity in terms of energy scale, even exotica like vector-like quarks, etc. Then there's a big one, supersymmetry. Its cousin in the form of dark matter and its searches, and eventually some concluding words. So let me remind you that the LHC was conceived in order to probe in full the energy range from 100 to about 1,000 GeV, meaning the full electroweak scale. The idea was to find out what this electroweak symmetry breaking was due to, and that meant either to not find the infamous Higgs boson, in which case it would be some kind of strong longitudinal boson scattering, for which we would not really have enough statistics at 13 and 14 TeV. Or if we find the Higgs, to basically call on new physics to explain why the mass could possibly be low. And what would be the new physics? Perhaps new dynamics in the form of some kind of composite Higgs, or some new symmetry that stabilizes the Higgs in the form of supersymmetry, and so on. And then to make an exhaustive search for all sorts of new stuff, like extra dimensions, little Higgs theories, hidden valleys, etc., etc. We'll talk about these in due course. And to complete, this is the content of the talk today. To complete the story, of course, the LHC is supposed to also do all of these probes indirectly via the B physics program of LHCb, and then in addition to study heavy ion collisions at ALICE, but also at CMS and ATLAS. So, pre-Higgs, what did we know? We knew that there has to be this Brout-Ongler Higgs potential, whose minimum is not at zero, in order for symmetry breaking to occur. And in order to preserve this, there were two things. One is that if one computed the quantum loops, bosons come in with a plus sign, fermions, in particular the top, comes in with a negative sign, and because the mass of the top is very large, it means that it can take this potential and curve it down like this, meaning that this would not be a true minimum. So what this means is that there's a minimum mass for the Higgs boson as a function of the energy scale that one lets run in the loop. So if one puts a Higgs mass here and here the energy scale, this stuff here is basically not allowed because it would not lead to a stable vacuum. On the other hand, the triviality bound, as it's called, avoiding the Landau pole here, meant that there's a maximum, an upper limit on the Higgs mass in order to avoid basically a trivial theory. And this region here is the one that is fully allowed by these two rough calculations. And then what happened? Well, we found the Higgs boson. It was a zero plus particle. It had a mass of 125. And in addition, all of its properties seem to come out right within the standard model. This is the one of the full electroweak fits of all the observables, MH, MW, gamma W, MZ, along with all the precision measurements from LEP and so on. Make a long story short, the standard model is extremely consistent right now. There's an overall chi-squared min of 18 probability of about 20%. And this is mainly coming from these two asymmetry, the lepton asymmetry from SLD and the forward-backward asymmetry from LEP. These are the two off-liers. Everything else is basically lying fully in line with the expectations. Not only that, but even the fact that we found something at 125 and zooming in now here and putting a line at 125 here, all we can say is that, okay, 125 meets this instability region somewhere around 10 to the 9, 10 to the 10 GeV. That on the one hand is good news because it means there's some kind of new physics there. It's bad news because 10 to the 10 is way out of money reach, of course. And then there's a counter argument that you don't really need to live right there where the standard mole goes all the way to infinity, because after all, even if you have this instability, it doesn't mean anything, because a lifetime could be so long that you already have one lifetime measurement up to now, 13 giga years. So, you know, we have another 13 giga years to go. So this is actually not such a big deal. So with this, what we have is basically one main path in order to see whether there's anything to understand more in detail this thing, which is to study the scalar sector in extreme detail. Is this a very Higgs boson of the standard model? Is it really an elementary particle? Is it a composite one? Is it one of five Higgs bosons? Is there an extended sector, etc., etc.? What about dark matter? Is it natural, which is a bit of an unnatural question, and so on? Now, today, most of these questions will not be addressed in this talk, because I think they deserve to be covered in full detail in a talk that's fully dedicated to the Higgs. Instead, I will start from this one and try to see what it means for new physics beyond what we're saying here. So, the hunt for new physics. There's basically two reasons for it. One, there are real reasons and virtual reasons. The real reasons is simply that we know about dark matter and its existence. We know about neutrino masses, so these are the two experimental observables that cause it. The virtual reasons come from naturalness. In particular, we know that quantum mechanics destroys anything and lets it go to very large values as long as it's not protected by a symmetry. In the case of the Higgs, there is no chiral symmetry or equivalent to protect it. So what that means is that these quantum loops, especially the four Higgs point here, is basically proportional to the largest energy scale. Is this bad? Well, some people will say the anthropic principle comes in and saves everything. Other people will say what this is saying is that basically there is dependence of something which is around 125 squared GeV squared, okay, on something which can go all the way to the highest energy scale, say the Planck mass. This is like saying that in order to describe the hydrogen atom, we need to know about the motion of every quark, or to describe the Earth-Sun interaction, we need to know about every molecule on Earth. We know that effective theories work extremely well, and we don't have this very, very short distance dependence. So this is what basically makes it so crazy and unnatural. What are the solutions? One, you make a composite Higgs. There's some kind of new dynamics that bounds two somethings into the Higgs. Solution number two, supersymmetry. So what you do is you introduce the mirror images, fermions to bosons, bosons to fermions, and therefore you cancel the divergences in the Higgs. Solution number three, the so-called family of little Higgs theories, where the Higgs is now a pseudo-Goldstone boson of some ultimate theory. And you don't go immediately to the theory of everything, but instead you say, you know what, this is actually just another effective theory to the next order of magnitude around 10 TeV. And the loops cancel by particles of same spin. This is actually important. And finally, for example, vector-like quarks and so on, they all belong to this kind of category. And finally, there's extra dimensions. If you bring in gravity at a very low scale, clearly you change the running at the scale where gravity appears. So no longer do you need to run all the way to Max Planck. So there are these four grand categories. All of them demand the presence of new particles. So whether you have more Higgs bosons, or Suzy partners, or new W's and Z's, a fourth generation top and bottom, not a standard fourth generation, we will see that it was totally excluded by the LHC. And the path to these searches has been to basically look for these higher mass states. We speak of higher mass states because clearly, since we haven't observed them so far, there must have been an explanation, so it must be in the mass. In the beginning, you start the searches being as inclusive as possible. And then as time goes by, you go after targeted searches more and more and more in order to increase the reach. So you tune the analysis and you go after very specific signatures. Broadly speaking, again, there are five categories of searches. Searches for new resonances, so you look for a peak. Then you start diluting your demands for what you're going to see. You go non-resonant, so you go for deviations in the tails of QCD and electroweak, for example, in signals like compositeness. Then you go ultimately non-resonant by including missing ET channels, and the grand example here is SUSY with R parity conservation. Then you extend SUSY and you go after dark matter searches where you have no idea about what the vertex could potentially be except for a rough parameterization. And eventually you go into exotica, like really long-lived stuff. So these are basically the five categories. Now, before I proceed, I have to pay homage to the fact that it's been an incredible set of measurements of the standard model of all processes that we know. These are basically QCD calculations, but quite a few of them, they involve electroweak particles, and they're basically spot on. What you see here is a fraction data over theory out of ATLAS. And to make a long story short, we have a theory that allows us, given the parton distribution functions, a matrix element here that comes out of QCD and electroweak, and the parameterizations that we have for fragmentation at the end, to basically build extremely reliable models for what we see. Modulo 10-20%, that then data-driven methods come in and correct. So here we need to at least pay kudos to this incredible success. Now, new resonances. What is the simplest thing that one can look for? Well, one is the new dynamics, compositeness, axial gluons, digit searches. So this is simple because it goes into two objects. Going to the next level, if one has new vector bosons, W prime, Z primes, for example, from extra dimensions or some new U1 sector, again, one has the two-body decays, but then also two-body decays that into stuff that goes into stuff itself. So WW, WZ that themselves decay into two bodies. So you go into three and four-body final states, and eventually, high mass top and bottoms like little Higgs series vector quarks and so on, vector-like quarks and so on. The archetypical search is the digit mass search. So basically, you just take all digit events with a minimal missing ET anti-cut in order to make sure that the event is fairly well balanced. By now, thanks to 13 TV, we have gathered some extremely high mass events like this one, which is at 8 TV, not a typical event. Obviously, it's way out in the tail. It's out here, basically. But as you can tell, we have a very smooth fit of this mass distribution. This is an empirical four-parameter fit. There's no sign of a resonance beyond it. You can play the same game for an excited quark, whereby you have this guy decay to a photon in the quark, and you end up with similar kind of limits. Now, where are the important developments? The question has been how to extend this to lower mass. There's basically two ways. One is to have a dedicated trigger. The problem with a dedicated trigger is that you need a lot of resources in terms of events that you're going to write in storage of what you're going to write to tape. Thus, we invented the so-called data scouting, which is the idea that you take an extra kilohertz, let's say, of events, but for those you only store the jet information. The equivalent in ATLAS now is called the TLA, the trigger level analysis, whereby you select objects at the high level trigger and you store just those. Now that enables you to basically go lower, of course, in PT and mass of what it is that you're probing. As a result, for example, the searches now extend all the way down to something like 400 GeV. What's even more is that it's useful to compare with other experiments, other colliders. And here's, for example, a parameterization due to Dobrescu and Yu, who use a Z prime from a hypothetical U1, let's call it B sector. Now, for that guy, you introduce a coupling, a vector coupling to the Z here, GB over 6. This is the strength of the interaction, 1/6, in order to have the equivalent of the hypercharge. And from there, you can compute everything, including the width and so on. Then you end up with limits of the coupling as a function of the mass. And you can put the high mass ATLAS and CMS stuff here, but you can also overlay the old searches from CDF and D0, which correspond to these guys. And interestingly enough, this type of data scouting allows you to enter this region here, which was completely unprobed, because you see, the moment you hit about 800 GV, which means a PT of jet of about 400, you started losing sensitivity altogether from the previous searches. So that's what this buys you. There's another trick. The other trick, instead of dedicating too much high trigger bandwidth, is to say, what I will do is that I'll take two jet events, whereby one is a gluon and the other one is a composite object, not composite object, sorry, an object that decays into two, for example, a Z prime. So I will put a very high threshold here on this guy, say 500, 600, 800 GV, but this is putting a PT cut on this guy, not a mass cut on it, because of two times a PT of the jet if it's two jets from the very beginning. So what that enables you to do is you have this recoil, and then use the system in order to look for a resonance inside. The method has been used both by Atlas and by CMS in order, again, to extend into this lower mass region. The really, really nice thing is that, and if this was a specialized seminar, I would spend a third of it on this analysis, is that by using substructure methods to look for these two decay objects in here, you can actually decompose that object, and for the first time ever, if you look at the mass of the jet recoiling against the trigger jet, we actually have a very clean peak on the W and the Z. This is actually the first that I know, clear, way beyond anything else, demonstration of a W and Z that does not come from a top decay. W's from top decay we've seen quite a while ago, and we had the very, very first all-hadronic W signal from a dedicated UA2 trigger way back more than 20 years ago. But a fully hadronic state with only jet requirements and nothing else, this is the first time that we have a clear WZ peak. We actually set now limits that allow you to reach, because of this diagram, in mass you go all the way to 100 GV. 100 GV, so that's all the way down at the level of the Z. So back in the diagram, putting everything together in the diagram of GB versus Z prime mass, you actually have this search that takes you from 300 all the way to 100 GV. And as we will see at the end of the talk, this part here of the plot is particularly relevant to the dark matter searches. Now, extra dimensions. You know the idea of our times. The idea of our times is that, you know, there's all these strings, they're supposed to live in 10 dimensions because only then is the theory consistent. Now, whatever it is that scale at which that happens, dimensionally, we must have that our four-dimensional Planck mass must be the volume of however many curled up dimensions there are and the corresponding power of the 4 plus D theory. This is just dimensions. And just solving that, with using the traditional view that these extra dimensions are tiny at the size of the current Planck mass, a four-dimensional Planck mass, you end up with an extra dimensional volume which is tiny, tiny, tiny. And then comes the idea, why not make this volume large? If basically you allow this volume to be large, in other words, much, much larger than the inverse of this value here, then you allow the true Planck mass to actually go down all the way to a TV. Why? Well, because the size of the dimensions have grown larger. This solves a problem, actually, solves many problems in one shot. First of all, if you take the three couplings of strong, weak, and electromagnetic, which are now squeezed here, and you pat the you add the gravitational one, we don't have a gravitational theory, quantum theory of gravity. So dimensionally, this has to go as energy squared over Newton constant. So this has to run as E squared, where these guys run logarithmically. So by the time you get down to our energies, we're down here, which is a 40 orders of magnitude down. Now instead, if you were to take this gravitational line, and suddenly you say at some distance of, say, a TV, you change the rate at which you run, because now you can propagate in the extra dimensions, puff, you come out here, and this scale, the Planck scale, is nothing but the mirage. It's a mirage because in reality, unification comes much earlier. This is actually one of the coolest ideas in the past 20 years, and it's had many incarnations. One is this, the most known one, which is that of a curled dimension. So if you run around, the momentum is quantized in multiples of 1 over r, and therefore you end up with resonances, which are original mass squared plus 1 over r squared. And since this is now at the level of a TV, you should get a TV, a 2TV, a 3TV, and so on, resonance. Or correspondingly, things like the Randall syndrome, whereby the extra dimension is, say, a fifth dimension over here. Our world is exactly as we know it with our metric and everything else, except that we have a little factor up front that depends on the extra dimension. Since we don't propagate in the extra dimension, we're totally blind to this factor. And there is a whole new world out there, another new metric corresponding to this, and so on, that we don't get to see. But you don't care. But whatever happens here, by the time it gets to here, it's all warped, as it says, because of an exponential factor. You trade basically a mystery of all these orders of magnitude in energy scale to a mystery of why would this number be around 10 to 13, which is what is needed. Anyway, these are useful toys. Experimentally, what do they mean now? Well, the first thing you look for is obviously a Z prime. Beautiful, clear signatures into muons or electrons. Limits from, we haven't seen anything. Limits from ATLAS and CMS hover around the region of about 3.5 TeV. You do the same thing for W prime. This time it goes to a lepton and a neutrino. This is an electron event from CMS, a muon event from ATLAS, missing energy on the opposite side. You use a transverse mass, which is why you don't have a peak, but rather a Jacobian peak, which is lopsided on the left since you miss some of the neutrino momentum. And again, limits that hover around right before 5 and right above 4. Whenever you see differences of this type, is because the 13 TeV analysis between the two hover between the 2015 data set, which is 3 inverse femtobarns, or 4, and the IChep luminosity, which was a factor 4 larger at 13, 14 inverse picobar, inverse femtobarns. You can also look for diphotons. And this is the run one result from 8 TeV. You can actually have very, very clean signatures for photons. So what you see here is a photon signature versus a background from JETS, from ATLAS. So you see that the cleanliness of the signal is superb. There seems to be nothing here. So you set up limits. This is, for example, the limit from ATLAS. And all was calm. Then came 2015. And there was this super excitement of a little blip at 750 GeV. On purpose, I did not put a little red circle or anything else. And it was basically in CMS and it was in ATLAS. It created a lot of literature and a lot of literature. And following that, in came the next year, and it basically just died an untimely death. The original p-value, the probability that the background would fluctuate here and here, is these dashed curves. Originally, we thought that they were at exactly the same point. It turned out that they were slightly shifted. I think the biggest thing that this thing had going for it is the fact that it was seen by the two experiments at the same time. If one guy was shifted and the other one was down or whatever, there wouldn't have been anywhere near as much excitement. Anyway, it's gone. The new solid lines are the new p-values. And they are really consistent with the statistical fluctuation. In addition, other channels like Z gamma, etc., they have nothing. Next level of complexity is to go to W primes and Z primes that decay into vector bosons, including VH, and then even to things like TT bar, in other words, objects that decay to others. Simplest thing is to let this thing decay into all leptonic states. These plots are from 8 TeV, and they allow us to reach masses of about 1.5 TeV, both on ATLAS and in CMS. The more interesting part comes if you allow these bosons to decay hadronically, because first of all, you pick up in branching fraction. Now, if you have an object that decays hadronically, the archetypical example is a Z prime that goes into two top quarks. If the mass of this guy is 2 TeV, you get a 1 TeV for each top, which corresponds to a gamma factor of about 5. So this thing is very boosted, and what it means is that, first of all, the leptons will fall inside the B-jet. They will no longer be isolated, so that means you need new algorithms and so on. But even more importantly, The all hadronic part, if it goes to QQ from the W and the B quark here, they all get merged into one big overweight jet, weight-challenged jet is a politically correct form. There have been a number of ideas on how to separate these things. The mass drop, there's three or four different algorithms. The easiest one to explain, which the one I pick up here, is N sub jettiness. What you do is you take a wide jet, and then internally you run it under different hypotheses of N objects inside. You run it for one, for two, for three, for four, minimizing basically this quantity here, which is for everything that you have inside, the PT of the particle, and the minimum distance to the N objects. So if you have something which is spread out like this into two different subclusters, this will give you a minimum when you actually, each particle goes into one cone or the other cone, that's the minimum distance. As opposed to something which is more uniform, that will give you values that are high. So to make a long story short, this variable here goes to zero when you pick up the right multiplicity for the decay, and goes to one when it's something more uniform. This is W to QQ, this is QCD, which is more uniform. Now, doing this, there's, for example, a W decay. Here is the tau 1 hypothesis, the tau 2 hypothesis. The purple is the W, the blue is the QCD. Here they are reversed. So it shows that the two together have a big discrimination, which is why we typically use the ratio. And here is tau 2 over tau 1. Here is the QCD, and this is the W signal. Correspondingly, you can play the game with 2 and 3, this time from top decays, and this is what you end up with, tau 3 over tau 2. This is background from accidentals, and this is top decays. This can be used to actually separate the two, and it has been done at both CMS and ATLAS in all possible topologies. So you have the one lepton topology with a merged jet. This is when you can actually separate them. This is when they're merged. Or all hadronic, when you have jet, all merged, and you end up with limits in run one. That here is the update from the few analyses that we have from IChep. Here is the distribution, the tau 3-2. This is a signal that we expect from the top decays. This is the background. This is the mass of the jet, the red peaks at 175, so this is clearly picking top decays. And this is the mass of the TT bar signal. And there is no enhancement anywhere, which is why you end up with a limit of around 3 TV. Most of these limits hover around 3 TV, 3.5 TV, like the Z prime. The corresponding analysis from ATLAS ends up with a limit which is about the same. It's a little weaker only because it's analyzed a factor 4 less luminosity. There was no update for IChep, I think. This is for top. What about WW and WZ decays? Using the same method, if you look at the so-called pruned jet mass, you can actually, in the Monte Carlo, expect to get a peak at the W and Z. Of course, the resolution is not good enough to tell the difference. And what was tantalizing in run one is that both CMS and ATLAS had an excess around 2 TV. This one, actually, the one from ATLAS, made much more, a bigger splash in the news. Let's fast forward. Actually, the new data is here from 13 TV. This is the discriminant as before. Mass WW from CMS doesn't seem to indicate anything. And in fact, the current limit crosses the line at 2 TV and it's spot on. There's no sign of any excess. And the same thing actually holds true for ATLAS. There is only one hadronic channel, which is a bit higher, but all the others are not indicative of anything going on. There was one other thing that captured the imagination of theorists in run one, which was a small excess in leptoquarks. Leptoquarks are necessary if the proton is to decay. If it goes to electron, positron, and pi zero, for example, you need a mediator that's going to carry both numbers. The unknown thing about the leptoquark is A, the mass, B, the branching ratio into electron and quark, and neutrino and quark. So that is basically beta, and 1 minus beta is the other one. One more hypothesis that you have first generation, second generation, third generation, electron leptoquarks, muon leptoquarks, and tau leptoquarks. The simplest one are the electrons, and what happened in run one is that this is the background expectation, this is the data. There was an excess in the minimum mass of electron and jet, which if you translate it into mass leptoquark versus this branching ratio, the solid lines is the observed limit. The dashed line is the expected one. Since this is always inside, and this is both for high values and for low values here of beta, it means that the excess was there both for the electron and for the neutrino channels. Fast forward into run two, and basically it's gone. There is no excess at the 13 TV data. This was looked at with the 2015 data. This is ST, the total sum of PTs and missing ET and so on, the mass of the EE and the mass of the E-jet, where you would get close to getting a peak. There's nothing. The limit now goes up to more than a TV. New fermion generations. One thing that's not advertised is that the LHC basically killed the presence of a standard fourth generation. If one was to extend the CKM matrix and add a B prime and the T prime, and you make the hypothesis that the reason why these are not affected very much, because we know that 3x3 matrix is essentially unitary, is because this 2x2 contains all the transitions of the primes, so mainly to the third generation. Then you look for all sorts of combinations into T prime and B prime decaying into B, W, top, W, B, and so on. And there was no sign of it. No sign of it translates into limits on the mass plane between VT prime, B prime, if you want, and this is the so-called A, and the mass itself, which hover around 600, 700 GeV. Now, if you have a new quark that does not decouple, and this was a paper by Juadi et al., that basically does not decouple from the Higgs, it would have made a very significant change to the branching fractions and to the observed cross-sections for the Higgs. We do not see any such change in the branching fractions of the Higgs, so out goes a standard fourth generation that couples with the standard couplings to the Higgs. In other words, with a mass, 650 GeV would make a huge difference. The other alternative for an extra sector would be to hypothesize vector-like quarks. Remember, we need the loops to run in there in order to make the cancellation to keep the mass stable. Now, remember that the charge-current interaction is basically a current with a boson here, and it's decomposed into a right-handed and the left-handed one. Electroweak theory says that the right-handed current is zero. It's only the left-handed one that survives. In come vector-like quarks that basically introduce quarks now that have a right-handed component that also transform as not singlets under SU2 lepton. In fact, they transform depending on the representation that we're going to choose. TL, and so left-handed and right-handed top quarks would transform the same way under SU2. Since a current has both components now, it is vector-like. Of course, it's a quark, so it's still spin a half. It's strongly interacting, meaning that it's a triplet under SU3. And as for the hypercharge, it's whatever it's needed, so that given the SU2 representation, you conserve the charge. Now, given that, what does it mean? Well, you have lots of options here. One is that you make the Higgs to be a composite state of a standard particle and the VLQ. The other one is that the Randall-Sundrum model, together with all its excitements, has right-handed components for these quarks. And the other thing is little Higgs effective theories, whereby same spin partners are the ones that cancel the loop divergences. To us, the signature is that if you are making these things here at the interaction, they would decay into quark and ZHW, or if you look closely, BW, TH, and TZ. So these are now really composite decays where each one of these objects decays into two or three objects on its own. Again, you end up with boosted searches, like for example, here is a top that decays into three, a Higgs that decays into two B jets that have to work off of the jet substructure methods, and you end up with mass distributions that correspond to limits which are around a TV or so. There's a few updates from 13 TV, and so far there's nothing. Finally, we go to the non-resonant new physics. So the prime example before we go into SUSY is the possibility of some new strong interaction between the quarks, which would be effectively something like a four-point interaction. So this would get added into standard QCD with its Rutherford scattering, 1 plus cosine squared theta here, which is a red curve. And there would be some interference term, and then eventually this thing, which would go as 1 over lambda squared, the diagram, lambda to the fourth, the whole cross-section. Now, because looking, so this is Rutherford. The dotted line is QCD because of the scaling violations. And this uniformity here, this uniform line here, would correspond to the four-point interaction. You can flatten this line by making this change of variable. Instead of cosine theta, you go to chi. And in terms of chi, Rutherford scattering is basically a straight line. QCD has a small slope because of scaling violations, and new physics would basically show up right here, which is chi of 1 corresponds to theta of 90 degrees. So these are the chi distributions. The update at 13 TV comes from Atlas. CMS doesn't have an update on this yet. You can tell that there is no excess at the zero bin. It's always consistent with the QCD. And depending on whether one assumes constructive or destructive interference, this is constructive, this is destructive, you get limits in the compositeness scale of 13 to 20 TeV. So this actually exceeds even the center of mass energy. And finally, we get to the big one, SUSY. It's a superb symmetry. It cancels, it stabilizes the Higgs. Perhaps it helps with the unification. But above all, perhaps above all, if you are to avoid fast proton decay, and this is a primary reason for asking that this guy here be stable, it's to introduce R parity in order to avoid fast proton decay, we have a great dark matter candidate. So this is sort of 3 for the price of 1, special sale for Black Friday. Now, what we know about SUSY is we know all that about its production, because it's strong production, so we can compute the cross-sections. Because of this, we even have the kinematics. This is a T-hat production, so it means that a 500 GeV quark would be produced with a mean PT of roughly half the mass, 250 GeV. So these are large cross-sections, hard PT, lots of jets, high missing ET, potentially leptons and Bs also in there. Despite the conventional wisdom, I keep saying it because somehow people are quite dismissive, SUSY is actually one of the most predictive theories we have. It specifies the spins and the couplings of all the superpartners, everything. It's actually as predictive as the standard model if the masses and the CKM matrix were not measured. That's a big if. So we've been looking for this kind of thing, which is spectacular all hadronic events and missing ET, perhaps with a lepton and missing ET recoiling against jets. And what are the big categories of SUSY? Well, if you take all the superpartners, the left-handed ones, the right-handed ones, you know, doublets, of course, for the left-handed ones, because they follow the same gauge couplings as representation and therefore couplings as in the standard model. These are singlets, so they can decay, for example. They don't have to go through the weak interaction. And you put them all here, you basically have 9 factorial different ways of ordering them because the mass we know nothing about. So that leads you to 3 broad categories. And one, basically, the lightest guy, the LSP, is a weakly interacting neutral particle. The other one is you have a charged massive particle at the end. For example, something like a right-handed electron. And finally, R hadrons, whereby the LSP is a colored object. And that would give you, you know, the infamous R hadrons and so on. So these are the 3 broad categories of SUSY. Now, this one is the one that has received most of the attention, clearly, because it also gives you the dark matter candidate as well. For a while, especially during the LEP era and pre-LHC, the constrained MSSM that made the additional assumptions of a common scalar mass for everything, a common gauge genome mass for everything, and potentially a different mass here for the two Higgs partners because of the extra coupling between the two, the so-called mu. From there, you run the RGEs and it gives you the mass of everything else. It's extremely predictive. It's actually beautiful. And even more, it takes one of the two Higgses, and as you run it, it gives a mass squared which crosses zero, and therefore it triggers electroweak symmetry breaking. It's theoretically extremely pleasing. Of course, what happened is that we run and run and run, and in the end of the day, in the plane of M0, M1 half. So M1 half is a common mass of all the spin half particles. So the gluino, which is spin 1/2, is roughly 2.5 times the mass that you read over here. So when you read asymptotically a limit that all of this is excluded, so that means that the gluino is above something like 1300, 1400 GeV, irrespective of the squarks. As for the squarks are basically ellipses on this plane. Again, squarks above 1.4 TeV is what we allow. Everything else is excluded. The effort that's gone into making this plot is gigantic. In itself, it would deserve a whole seminar. We've had two bits of excitement in run one. They both were there in the dileptons, one from CMS, whereby we had the signal that was consistent with the decay of a chi2 that goes into a chi1 and two leptons. This would give you an edge at the mass difference of the two. So if you look at EE events, mu mu events, and this is the invariant mass, this is the data and the background fit, you see clearly the Z. You go into EMU combinations that clearly don't have this resonance effect, which is mainly TT bar, and you use this EMU to transport it here, and you see that there's actually an excess which is pseudo-consistent with an edge. This was a 2.5 sigma effect. And you see it here, this is a small excess that there was, in run one. In Atlas, instead, the excess was in events that had a Z. For example, something like this, where you have a chi1 that goes into a Z and the gravitino, for example, in a gauge-mediated model and so on. Data versus background expectation, and you see an excess here. It was actually present only in the electrons, not in the muons. So what about the cross result? CMS on Z events are spot on, no excess. Atlas off Z events, if you look to the left, spot on. So CMS refuted the Atlas signal and Atlas is CMS signal. What's happened at 13 TeV? So at 13 TeV, CMS is now at low mass. There's a cut at the Z, that's why it goes down. There is now no sign of excess. Atlas continues to have an excess at the Z. And it's basically at the same magnitude as run one, this time in EE and mu mu. Unfortunately, one cannot compare the two analyses, CMS and Atlas, because the cuts here have changed. The PTs have gone up to 50 GV instead of 20 GV. So the die is not really cast on whether this object is excluded or not. We have to wait for the higher statistics. Now, with the CMSSM no longer our gauge on where we can reach things and so on, people had to turn into some way of parameterizing the effect of the different mass spectra, since masses is what we don't know. This is the full spectrum of the CMSSM. One particular point for M0, M1/2, tangent beta, all the parameters. Once you fix the five parameters of the CMSSM, you have the full decay chain. Everything, branching ratios, everything else. Remember, we said it's extremely predictive. Of course, this is also its curse. Because of all this specificity, you can exclude it quite easily. So in comes the simplified model spectra, which is, it says, I don't know about all this cascade. I know about the highest object that you're going to create here. I know about the lightest object that's going to escape as missing ET. And in between, you have some transition that's going to create visible energy. So to vulgarize this diagram, I create this simplified, thus the name. So you have the object that created an intermediate particle, and then eventually the chi0. And you end up with plots of, say, gluino mass versus the LSP mass. At 45 degrees, of course, there's nothing allowed because by definition, this is the lightest guy. And in here, you now start excluding different gluino masses, quark masses, and so on. And the diagrams have become now truly generic. You see here you know, the blob for the strong cross section, and then two squarks that decay into quark and LSP, or a gluino that goes into quark and the chi1 squark, quark chi1 zero, and gluino that goes into QQ bar and chi1 zero. The advantage of these LSPs, or of these SMSs, is that they allow you to actually understand whether something has escaped you when you didn't realize it. So if you go, for example, into the gluino squark mass plane, the limits from Atlas from run one, this is the limit that comes from there if the mass of the LSP is zero. Now suppose that you let the mass of the LSP go to almost 200 GeV and almost 400 GeV, and suddenly this limit here becomes a green line, so you end up with these white spots, and in the blue, you end up with this only excluded, and all of this is now allowed. So the secret there is to understand whether basically in this over-constraint of the CMSSM we have let things escape us. So with this, then came the second level, which said, okay, tell you what, we know that squarks and gluinos are above a TV, so out goes naturalness, but what is really the minimum requirement on naturalness that we expect? And the answer is, well, what you really need is to have, you can let the light quark partners go way up in mass, so this is mass on this axis, you can let them go way up there. Also the same thing for some of the gauge boson partners. As long as you keep the third generation here in order close in mass to the weak sector so that the top quarks cancel the top, you still end up with pretty good cancellation. So you don't need them all. You can have some kind of minimal requirement. It also turns out that the mass of these guys receives corrections from the mass of the gaugino because these are now spin zero particles. So they're a little bit like Higgs. They feel the highest mass fermion that runs in the loop, and that is now the gluino. So that means that the gluino can now not be very massive. So therefore, if these guys are not very massive, this guy is also not very massive. Everybody else is allowed to go wherever they want because they have soft SUSY mass terms, so these are all the squarks, spin zero. So all the searches then concentrated into searches for the top squark, the so-called stop. The previous limits are no longer available simply because when you have top quarks in the decay, the signature is totally different. And the other big scenario is, what happens if the LSP is so high in mass that the mass splitting that we have here is basically tiny, so therefore the visible energy is tiny, and as a result it all escapes, and therefore what happens is that basically you just don't have enough missing ET in the event, since you don't have enough visible energy. It could have escaped. So these two paths have been pursued. How do you make stops? There are two ways. One is to make gluinos, and the gluinos decay into TT bar and chi1 zero, for example, or to make direct stops. This cross section is basically a factor 8 below the QQ bar cross section. So it's suppressed because of cross section, and then the signature is more complicated. What does it decay to? Well, it depends on the mass. Again, the mass unknown is what makes a big difference. This is the mass of the stop, this is the mass of the chi zero. If the mass difference is that of the top and above, it would go into a top and the chi one zero. Below that, if it's still above the mass of the W, it would go into a B and the W, like a top and the LSP. And then below that, it would go just to a four-body decay, which is basically a B and the W star and the chi one zero, this guy going into two objects. This is super hard, this is super easy. And actually, this is reflected in the limits. There are limits on the stop, both in terms of gluino-induced decays. This is mass gluino, mass LSP. You get limits in the gluino mass that hover around 1.7 TeV. This is from the most recent run. The same thing also from Atlas here. The limits are slightly better. You can actually also see that there is the observed versus the expected is slightly worse, and more interestingly, in the direct search, this is the expected, this is the observed, this is the expected, this is the observed. So for the first time, these SUSY searches have some kind of very weak hope that there might beginning to be something that's rising its head little by little. So anyway, the current limits are about 900 GeV for zero LSP mass, and you get up to 400 for the LSP. These are becoming significant. If this thing was hovering all the way out here and above a TV, if it came to this line here, that would start looking very, very grim for SUSY. These lines that they've been covered here, and there's a bazillion lines under these nice blue colors and so on, are the result of a gigantic effort. I had to flash this just as an example. The other big sector is the electroweak sector, whereby now you produce the so-called electroweakinos, and you can make charginos and neutralinos and so on and so on. And again, it leads to limits, which are basically for the neutralinos and charginos, if you assume that the second one and the chargino are roughly the same mass, about 700 GeV for an LSP hovering around 300, 400 GeV. Now, what could have escaped? What could have escaped is narrowing down on these strips here are the places where the mass differences between the stop and the LSP are small. Now, these are the so-called difficult regions. And narrowing down, so the by far the worst is if the stop is equal to the mass of the chi zero. In fact, if the two masses are very, very close to each other, then this thing is also extremely long lifetime. If the mass is, say, right here, it's identical to the top, so it's even worse, okay? And then in these corridors as well, you just don't have enough energy to see the final state decay products. So it's always at the limit of whoever you're decaying to. There are dedicated searches for that, and typically what they use is soft leptons. So for example, if you have this four-body decay, and the stop goes into a B, a chi-1-0, a lepton, and a neutrino, all because the mass difference between this guy and this guy is very small, the energy of these guys is tiny. It's almost as if they're not there. Now, this one is missing a TE. This one is a B that you don't see. This one you have some hope, but it's a soft lepton. Same thing here, soft lepton. So you go after soft lepton signatures. And with those, you manage to, now we concentrate on this light mass corridor, you manage to start excluding this type of area. Both CMS and ATLAS have carried analysis. Now, you notice that it never actually gets to the diagonal, because at that point the lifetime would blow up. Interestingly, as these limits get pushed up and up and up, even for the stop quark, there are always, in the end, one thing that remains for SUSY, which is the Higgs mu scale mu between the two doublets. And the fact there is that since this is actually a Dirac mass, and this is a gauge invariant term, it doesn't have the problem of the fermionic masses that you have in the SU2 standard model that are not gauge invariant. Those things are supposed to all stay light. And in fact, if anything, the mass splitting should be very, very small. We are now becoming sensitive to scenarios in which the electroweakinos give place to the lighter states as being Higgsinos with very, very small mass splittings. Currently, the limits are coming from LEP, but the current analysis of delta mass here as a function of stop, for example, when reinterpreted in this plane, will soon give limits beyond the 90 GeV of LEP. Then there's our parity violation. Here the field is dominated right now by ATLAS. There's a beautiful analysis, for example, on an all-hadronic search that is fully data-driven. There's a parametrization of all the jet multiplicities, because now the final state is an all-jet, final state without missing ET, without anything else. So all of these are binned in number of jets and number of B-jets and so on. And limits that hover, depending on the scenario, about a bit more than a TV and a half. There's also photon and gravity. There's a very significant number of RPV searches from ATLAS, little from CMS. As for exotic SUSY, long lifetime, strange signatures, RPV, etc., there's charged massive particles, that you can look for heavily ionizing tracks in the detector. So you look for ionization as a function of momentum, and you have a, this is charge one, this is charge two-thirds, this is a charge three, and so on. And we don't have any such excess in the data, and therefore you end up with limits, you cross, and you have limits of about a TeV or two. Same thing for R hadrons. And the zoo is actually incredibly rich from disappearing tracks. If you have, for example, a chargino that goes and goes and goes and then decays into a pi and the neutralino, you'd have a track that then disappears. And there's an impressive set of limits here on long-lived particles from 13 TeV as well from ATLAS. Final topic, dark matter. We produce it and supposedly it's dark, it escapes. So our only hope for triggering it to tape is to have an initial state radiation object. The more recent idea is to use VBF in order to get two of those, but then you tag via these two quarks. This is the archetypal example. So you have this monojet with nothing recoiling against it, the ISR, and you have the leading jet PT distribution and so on. Of course, you also have standard model backgrounds like Z2nu plus jet. The same thing can be done with photons. You radiate a photon, and again, you have no excess. Traditionally, what has happened is that in the standard plane of cross-section as a function of the mass of the dark matter particle, these are the direct search experiments, we have been overlaying our limits for spin-independent operators, whereby we have some reach at low masses, better than them, and at spin-dependent, we actually dominate the field, or so was the traditional thinking. Now, the way you go into this plane from our result is by basically taking a cross-section, which is something like the reduced mass divided by lambda, the effective scale. Now, that assumes that basically you have an effective interaction. That effective interaction presumably comes from somebody who knows about the quarks on the one side and knows about the dark mass matter on the other side. Now, if one is to be careful and takes this diagram, which is basically a propagator, puts the two couplings here, and then says that I'm going to make it equivalent to this, in other words, you expand the series, you see that this is valid clearly only when q squared is much smaller than m squared. In other words, when m squared, which is equal to the two couplings times lambda squared, is much less than that. However, q is essentially pt of the ISR jet. And you have something like 150 GV, 200 GV ISR jets. So this is actually a pretty low scale. So even worse, it means that the limits that we thought we have so far for weak couplings, which is most models where this thing is a small number, okay, lambda actually gets to become even lower. Or including loops actually brings in the effective scale even lower. So that means that this approximation is actually awful in some places. So for example, if you put mass dark matter in here, the square root of the two couplings, this has to be less than 4 pi because g squared over 4 pi is less than 1. So therefore, this is the EFT limit applies, okay? Okay, this is if you introduce the Rayleigh density, and this is the limit of the 4 pi here. So it's not valid over the entire plane. So the real thing to do is something like the SUSY limit, whereby you have the mass of the mediator here and the mass of the dark matter. This is, of course, a 45-degree line. And you end up again with this type of limits here. They're chosen for specific values of the couplings here, g chi and g to the quarks of 0.25 for vector and axial, and for scalar and pseudoscalar of 1. These are chosen in order to have widths up to of around 10% of the mass. Beyond that, the width becomes way too wide, sort of like a very heavy Higgs. With that then, what you have is, here is a trigger jet, and then on the other side, say a Z that decays into a chi-chi bar. And this can happen with a monojet or a mono vector, whereby what you have is a vector boson recoiling, not a jet, against the mediator and the two dark matter particles. And this can be either for vector or for axial vector, correspondingly for scalars. The interactions that you write down are the standard interactions. And in this effective model, this is basically now these plots correspond and look very much like the SUSY ones, because you have the mass here of the mediator and the mass of the dark matter, the 45-degree line, and you see that we cut off basically at around 2 TeV for the spin dependent and around 400 GeV for the spin independent, depending on whether it's a monojet or the mono V channel. If you then take the ATLAS limits are slightly lower because they have less luminosity from 2015 corresponding. Now, if you turn this into a cross section and you put the cross section here, the cross section is 1/mass, it's the inverse of this mass of the mediator. So therefore, this triangle now becomes this triangle, okay, which is why it looks this way. And this is where you see the current limits from, which are much more reliable than in the effective theory with respect to the direct searches. And indeed, in this region, we exceed them by quite a bit. Final step, you can actually take all of our standard model searches and reinterpret them now in terms of dark matter particles. And the reason is that, remember, we had this effective U1b for any Z prime. Well, you can play exactly the same thing here for the Z prime, except that now this is a mediator for dark mass, for dark matter. So cross-section is basically whatever GB to the fourth over gamma. And in the case of a dark matter particle, you don't have just the Z prime width, but also the width into dark matter particles. So equating the two cross-sections, and you say that now GB will have to be GQ over 6 in order to account for the difference with the quark, okay? And increasing the width by that, the widths go as the coupling to the fourth. You can solve for GB. You can put in 6 times that value. In other words, the 0.25 becomes 1.5. G dark matter is 1. And you let the mass of the final state be the mass of the dark matter particle. And you end up with 2 limits. In one case, the dark matter particles are heavier than the mediator, so GB is 3/2. At 0, it's 0.6. So if we go back to the diagram that we had, basically the region from here to here, and this is now a normal digit search, okay, implies limits in the dark matter, in the mediator mass, which is in fact the mass of the Z prime, which is why both in ATLAS and in CMS, now you put the mediator mass here and the dark mass, and so here's, for example, the digit trigger level analysis of ATLAS. You take the envelope of this to here. This region here is excluded. It's a very, very large area that's excluded from the digit search. By comparison, here is the traditional plus photon, plus Z, and the searches with monophoton, mono Z, and so on, the red lines, the triangles that we were talking about, and this is what the digit search excludes out of the power of this parameterization. This actually is a whole new thing, and it means that we can reinterpret all of our standard model results in terms of dark matter and obtain new limits. So what's next? I think that by now we've made incredible strides in understanding the standard model. It's not an EFT, it's a VEFT. It's a very effective field theory. One has to say that much of this has also been thanks to amazing next to leading order and next to leading order calculations. This is more relevant to the Higgs, but also it's helped here quite a bit. Theory has helped quite a bit. There is a strange 125 that to this day we have no idea what stabilizes it and keeps it low. Amazingly, we haven't seen anything new yet. Okay, supersymmetry is ever elusive, even though we're going after the little corners where it may have escaped. I must say, however, that the long-lived particles and the R-parity violation scenarios are extremely difficult, and I don't think we will ever exclude them for good. Exotica are for now just that, exotic things of the human mind, okay? And there's still many, many questions that go unanswered. Is it the very Higgs of the standard model? Is it elementary or composite? Is it the first SUSY particle? And so on, and so on, and so on. Now, the good news, I think, is that we have an extremely well-functioning accelerator. We have beautiful experiments that are taking incredibly good data, and our precision and methods are becoming better and better and better. And to close on a positive side, remember that even though with the Higgs boson, the standard model is now complete, and we think that we know all there is to know, okay, this brings us back to the times when we thought that our knowledge of nature was deemed to be complete. And no lesser a man than Lord Kelvin in 1900 said, "There is nothing new to be discovered in physics now. All that remains is more and more precise measurement." And we all know what happened 5 years after that, and 20 years after that, and 60, 70, 80 years after that. So I think that the current lull is basically just cause for us to measure things extremely accurately. At the same time, keep looking. Something will show up for sure. Et voilà. Thanks.
Thanks a lot. So there's time for questions.
I wanted to know, Paris, what you think about these vector-like quarks. Somehow nature went to this scenario, which is actually quite appealing at the end, of trying to couple left and right chiralities through the interaction with the X field somehow. And now you put in these guys, which basically seems to, you know, they forbid a lot of things somehow. They are just, you know, put by hand. What do you think about these vector leptoquark yourself? I mean, I understand that it can work, but is there anything appealing to these guys?
I thought you wanted me then to switch back on to here. Okay. So good question. I don't push any button. So the advantage of the vector-like quarks is that they arise naturally in many different places. And above all is that they are a viable model for a composite Higgs. So we don't, we have the traditional Higgs compositeness out of, say, a condensate, okay? The very, very original idea. That's extremely appealing because it gives a dynamic origin to the whole symmetry breaking and so on. So all of those theories continue to have that attraction, that they don't need any of the extra stuff, and they have a dynamical explanation. So this is one advantage. Second, we know that handedness is a mystery. It has to be put in by hand, essentially. And it is actually what's forcing us to say, because we have the handedness, that's because we cannot put in the mass terms by hand. That's why then we need the vacuum expectation value and the Yukawa couplings and blah, 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 blah. But let's not forget that we put it in by hand, okay? Let's also not forget that the neutrino sector is very likely, we don't know that. So there is indications, okay, that a right-handed sector that's not a singlet under our SU2, but has an additional SU2 or whatever you want to call it, could solve two or three problems in one shot. Okay? Now, what is that? It's an effective theory again. Because this is an extra sector, okay? And you stabilize the Higgs, because in this model you basically don't have a problem with the Higgs. The Higgs is just a remnant of our traditional SU2 left cross U1 that goes into U1 electromagnetic. That happens. We know that happens. Okay? Now, why the potential is that way? Because of the extra guys. So it doesn't exclude the fact that you need that breaking.
More questions?
So I wanted to offer you a magic wand and see what you would do with it. As a result of decisions and kind of the state of technology as it was, let's say, between 20 and 25 years ago, the next 15 years or so of the LHC are pushing to higher and higher luminosity. Given what we know today, using this magic wand, would you continue along that path, or would you try to go instead to higher energy? And how high would it have to be to make that switch worthwhile?
thankfully, I'm not the one making these decisions. But if I were making these decisions, I think the number one priority would be magnet R&D and to push for higher energy as quickly as possible. It is currently out of financial reach. Okay, you need to breach the gap. You need to bridge the gap. So a higher luminosity is within financial reach. Does it offer something? It does. It does because, first of all, I left out all the Higgs sector out of this discussion. Second, already there is a hint of things to come in this stuff. We are used to measuring our worth, not the way other fields do, for example, like nuclear physics or other or others. We put mass on the x-axis, and we say, with the LHC, you get up to Z prime masses of 4 TV. And then with a high luminosity LHC, the 4 TV becomes 4.5. So then financially, it looks like a very large number of CHF for 500 GV gain. But it's actually not true, because that's if you measure it only in this one-dimensional plane. In the plane of coupling versus mass, statistics actually makes a big difference. So we just have to make sure that we interpret the results for what they're for what they can stand for. In other words, what we say, we use the standard model branching ratios, we use the standard model couplings and so on and so on. We say the mass limit is that. Who said it's the same couplings? And in fact, with higher luminosity, you start you become much more sensitive to weaker interactions, different charges, and so on. So there's actually a direct benefit that will require for us to redraw the way we draw our mass limits and our physics reach in terms of energy scale and coupling, because they go together. And the ultimate example where they do go together is in this business here, whereby you actually have the trade-off. Or it's the coupling to the creation, the coupling to the decay guy, and the effective scale, if you want. The three actually go together, okay? And the mass mediator limit that we actually come up with corresponds to the three. So therefore, we cannot ignore the others, except we have been assuming a certain value, okay? So the high luminosity LHC is going to offer us a lot in terms of probing the scalar sector, in terms of probing weaker couplings, also in dark matter and so on, and the great bridge until we get higher energy. Do we need higher energy? You always need higher energy, because otherwise we would assume that we know everything already, and we know that by definition that's wrong.
Other questions?
Yes, you were a bit fast on the exotica, long-lived particles, and so on. I mean, one of the big questions here is to trigger on those signatures because they are so exotic. So can you say a few words on that?
It's tough. because already, if one is not careful, for example, with off-pointing objects, you kill them right in the trigger selection. Because typically our electron identification and muon identification, they want a nice track that's matched to the corresponding detector and so on. So there is, first of all, dedicated algorithms that allow for these things. Second, there's even special requirements at the level of the level one trigger that after, if the particle is slow, in fact, it will, you know that the size of our detectors is larger than one bunch crossing's worth. 25 nanoseconds is 7.5 meters. So in ATLAS, at any point in time, you have three active interactions. In CMS, you have two. So that means that the timing needs to be tuned at the level one to open the gate, the coincidence gate, in order to allow for something slower. Now, these things have happened. The ultimate is our hadrons that decay outside of beam time. So that means actually taking data while there is no beam, because presumably the R hadrons came out, they traveled to the calorimeter, got trapped there, and they're waiting and waiting, and 20 minutes later, poof, they decay into a flash of light. It depends on the lifetime. We shouldn't make fun of it, because the day we discover it, we will all be... what could be happening is that you actually build it, when you have the beam on, you actually build and build and build and build a number of them, and then eventually, during the gap, whatever that gap is, that number actually decreases, okay? And you have flashes. So here, the background is obviously calorimeter noise, and in fact, this was one of the first searches that we did, even before we had collision data. It started because we started taking the background data, meaning the noise in the calorimeter, before we had the beam. Because that, if you're looking for a jet, suddenly, 15 minutes after data taking has finished, right? So what's the background to this? It's how often one of these electronic channels will just go poof, like that. So that means the ultimate, which is the experiment needs to keep running even without beam, which is, we also do that. So triggering is big and a big issue and very tough issue for all of these long-lived signatures.
Maybe something related to your connection between the digest search at low PT and the dark matter. One question is, how low do you hope to get, how low in PT do you hope to be able to go in the end, especially in view of the increasing luminosity and, putting both constraints on reconstructing lower PT objects and triggering on them?
Come on. Okay. There's a reason why this thing stops at 100. Because after that, right. So that's about it. Below the W and the Z, life will be very, very difficult. Because amongst other things, you don't really have you don't have anything else that you can use as a calibration peak. Okay, what do you use it? Below that, what do we have? The upsilon? It doesn't really go into two jets. We also have to remember that the background from QCD becomes quite high, because then we're looking at low mass. Effectively, this is the mass of the jet, the wide jet that we have on the x-axis. So I think that this will stay with us. Now, this, of course, is what coupling we probe is a function of statistics, right? It's just statistics. The thing is that so far we've always been assuming a value for the coupling, and then we've been saying the mass limit is X, period, which is actually a very biased or conceited point of view, that we know what the coupling is. Now, this method, I think, has gone as low as it possibly can. And it really is beautiful. It really is beautiful, because when you're triggering with, if this was a jet, instead of a Z prime, it was a jet. Any PT cut on the gluon or the other jet basically means a mass cut of twice a PT on these two. So with the trigger thresholds, the equivalent mass cut is very high. Now, if instead you say, I'm cutting on PT, but I let the other object be a composite jet, suddenly, that PT cut from the trigger is not punishing you in mass. So it's really cool. It allows you to go all the way down. And, this is one of the coolest ideas of the last 4 or 5 years, actually. Together with the fact that we can see the substructure inside. And this, the WZ peak, is this is data, by the way.
No more questions? Thanks a lot then.